Ovarian endometrioma, I think surgery is the mainstay. It is the first line of therapy. But remember, in patients who have failed to conceive spontaneously after surgery, then ART is more effective than repeat surgery. So definitely you need to think of that. And the, as I said, the ovarian reserve should be monitored. And usually any endometrioma more than 4 centimeters, it would be better to remove. Now, if you've done the endometrioma surgery and you've done ART, after that, if it has failed, then it's controversial. But I believe in pooling of embryos, and sometimes we've done repeat surgery on these patients also. Expectant management of endometrioma when? I think these are some of the factors that you must remember. If your patient is older, she has a very poor ovarian reserve, there are bilateral endometriomas and prior surgical treatment. I think these are the cases where conservative therapy is actually indicated and you must think twice before doing surgery. Large ovarian endometriomas, you know, we have seen in IVF that if the endometrioma is really large, for example, there was a 10 centimeter endometrioma that actually did not allow any oocytes to grow on that side. The other contralateral ovary grew beautifully. So yes, at times we can do a repeat surgery. We've done repeat surgery on these patients. And there's a lot of concepts coming in about sclerotherapy, etc. I don't use it. But yes, there are a lot of papers saying that you can do that instead of the whole, you know, the laparoscopy. But I think laparoscopy is better than most of those therapies. Endometrioma and IVF, I think ultra-long Egonis protocol was first recommended. Today, we don't do it. We use the antagonist protocol. We freeze all the embryos and then give 2 months of GnRH analog before the frozen embryo transfer. Because not only the GnRH analog helps the endometriosis, but the endometrial effects of the GnRH analog are superb and you'll get very good results. So this is the baby go. During ovum pickup, if we rupture the endometrioma and we avoid aspiration and puncture, but if we do puncture it, we change the needle, we keep that egg isolated in a different dish. But the most important thing is whether you puncture or you don't puncture the endometrioma, admit the patient, give her 24 to 48 hours of IV antibiotics post-OPU because we don't use any antibiotics. Laparoscopic cystectomy on ovarian reserve with unilateral and bilateral endometrioma. This was a prospective observational study and which actually said that if you do cystectomy with bilateral, the ovarian reserve is really affected. And also in cysts which are more than 5 centimeters. Those cysts, the ovarian reserve really gets affected. So AMH drops are seen in these two particular age groups. This is unilateral versus bilateral, and you can see that after 3 months, the rise of the AMH is definitely more in the unilateral cystectomy. But what is now the papers are coming out that if you wait for 6 months to a slightly longer period, the AMH rise is better. So the insult of the surgery wears off as the time passes. So factors associated with a poor prognosis. We are seeing a lot of girls in Bombay with smoking. And I think smoking plus endometriosis really reduces the pregnancy rate. So you have to tell these girls to stop smoking. Then poor ovarian reserve, there's definitely lower chance of conception. And of course, the stage 4 endometriosis. Does the surgeon matter? I think this is a very important question, and in endometriosis, yes, it definitely matters. You need expertise. Endometriotic surgery is a specialized surgery with people with special skills who can do it, and those are the ones that will give you a very good results and do a complete surgery. In fact, this article is by Muzi et al, and I've been following his work for the last 10 years, and he's done some fantastic histopathology, you know, of the cyst walls, and he's compared how many follicles are there in those, and that's how this conclusion has come, that the person who's experienced will do the best job, especially in endometrioma surgery. Let's skip this. Also, endometriosis doubles the miscarriage rates. So I think it's very important to treat it, and that's why the surgery, the medical management is so important before you get this patient pregnant. This is my last slide, second last. Individualize patients according to different parameters. I think when you have a patient of endometriosis, what are the important factors that you must look at? The age of the patient, the degree of damage, if there's deep infiltrating endometriosis, presence or absence of ovarian failure, and other factors, obviously, like male factor, you know, other subfertility factors. It's very important to investigate the husband when you diagnose a woman with endometriosis, because you can change and hasten the treatment plan according to the individualize the treatment. Personally, what I feel when my patients come with endometrioma is refinement of the operating technique. I think that's very, very primary important when you decide for surgery. Long-term oral contraceptive or medical therapy if she doesn't want to get pregnant early and she's not trying for a baby soon. IVF should be offered to her sooner rather than later. I have not put in embryo pooling here, which we're doing regularly for all endometriosis patients. Collect the eggs, collect the embryos. So even a patient with low ovarian reserve will give you a pregnancy. In fact, one of my doctors, she was young, 30-year-old, just one embryo with very bad, grade 3, grade 4 endometriosis, she conceived. So age gives you the quality if the quantity is less. So very important to remember that. And I think oocyte cryopreservation is the new mantra. You must think of it. You must offer it to your patients. Especially, this is a very holistic approach to endometriosis, which you need to look at when you're treating these patients. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nandita, for your brilliant presentation. And particularly dissecting the different combined scenarios. Even it's a puzzling situation for the infertility practitioner. So not for few minutes we can come to an end. Your last word as individualize the case is the key word, and the many stallers are there. I will take their comments. There are questions from different corners of the country. So please, the questions are welcome.
Short answers, yes.
Yes, so the time is short, so Basho is asking for short answers. But we have many questions out here. The question from Dr. Shubhash Haldar, what is the definitive diagnostic tool apart from invasive one in a case of adolescent girls suffering from primary dysmenorrhea?
I think in these cases, an ultrasound is really good, but otherwise what you can do is you can give them oral contraceptive pills and see if the pain reduces. I think that is one of the best clinical ways to check it out. And follow up. If you can't really make a diagnosis, I think it's better not to miss out an endometriosis. So follow up this patient with 3 to 6 months of sonography, and they even do a transrectal sonography these days instead of a transvaginal in unmarried girls. But I think a trial with oral contraceptive pills and a sonography would be good. Worst situations, even MRI today have been suggested. If the pain is really, really bad, you can do an MRI.
Yes. A common question from Dr. Bibhu Chatterjee, Kolkata, and Sita Pal, the maximum duration of Dynagis therapy, and Bibhu asked it for, especially for the adolescent girls.
I think we've got studies today for 5 years, so I think we can safely do that, and it should work well. So I'm very happy with Dynagis. And I'd rather switch over to Dynagest than give the other progesterone. But of course, you have to take care of the bone mineral density, and you have to add calcium to these girls also.
And is there any guidelines? Is a question from Bornani Ghosh regarding should an adolescent be subjected to laparoscopy? How often and when?
Should? Sorry, I didn't get the question.
For an adolescent girl to be subjected to laparoscopy.
How often? That should not happen. Yes, adolescent girls, if the endometriomas are large and they're really interfering, I would leave a girl even with 6-7 centimeters of endometrioma if, you know, she's young and I can keep her on medical therapy, because Dynogest has been shown to reduce the size of the endometriomas. So in the adolescent, be very conservative. Don't really go in with the laparoscope as soon as possible, but try the medical therapy first. If it doesn't work, then I would do surgery and then again put her on post-operative medical therapy to prevent the recurrence. I think it's very, very important to treat these patients carefully so that their future does not get compromised.
And there is another question which is very important: how to handle the irregular bleeding with Dynogest?
I think it's more of counseling, and you need to tell the patients that but here the patients have a problem of pain. Anything that takes away the pain, they're really happy. They don't really bother too much about the irregular bleeding as such. But I do only counseling. I don't add anything else to Dynogest to take care of that.
You know, this is,
and if they're not comfortable, then I would switch therapies.
You know, this is being telecast all over the country.
Yeah.
So there is a question from Kanpur Center. Should COC be used for adolescent endometriosis continuously or cyclical?
Ideally, it should be used continuously. If you don't get a period, that's better. So I think the 3 months, you know, so that you get only 3 periods or 4 periods in a year, that would be the way to go.
Dr. K.K. Singhania, how to manage irregular bleeding during Dynogest treatment? That has been discussed, I think.
Yeah.
So Bapun Das, after surgery, if I will give Rumigest 65 weeks, then what to do?
If after surgery?
Yeah, after surgery, micronized progesterone is used.
Huh.
65 weeks, then what to do?
It depends what you want for the patient. If she wants to get pregnant, that's not the therapy. You should try and get her pregnant. If she wants, you know, long-term therapy, I would use even an LNG IUS. That's a fantastic module for treating patients who don't want to get pregnant.
Okay, someone from Kanpur say, hi to Mandira, my friend, on my behalf after her lecture.
Mandira. Nandita.
Nandita. So it has been misprinted.
Yes. Hi. That's Doctor, really sweet. Huh? That's the first one. I'm really...
from Nagpur Center, actually.
You know, when I was in medical college as a lecturer, I had this one student who came to me and called up and said, "Madam, I don't have any parents who are doctors and my exam is tomorrow. Will you give my number?" I mean, that was so entrepreneurial. You know, it was really amazing. I think these are some of the instances which stay in your mind. It's very sweet. Hi. I think that's really great.
Nandita, another important question.
Ow.
After how many days or months we can do embryo transfer in patient after stopping Dynogest or Rumigest?
You have to wait for 2 periods at least after Dynogest before you take the patient up. I mean, that's what I do in my practice. But usually after pickup, we use a GnRH analog. Because I think that is, you can immediately start the ET. Yeah, sorry.
Yes, there is another question. Is there any role of mifepristone for endometriosis? Or can we start COC along with Dynogest from the beginning to prevent that
irregular bleeding?
Yes, in adolescents. So these are the
I think you're using double the dose, then you might as well use one rather than use both. I think I would just, if there's too much trauma with Dynogest, I would switch to COC.
And mifepristone in endometriosis?
I don't have any experience with it. There are a lot of papers which are coming up, and I think we should wait for the results.
One of my patients, 25 years old, married for 1 year, keen for conception, and USG shows bilateral endometrioma, 3 centimeter each. Dr. Rajesh Gajbia from Nagpur Center, what about the combined approach for cystectomy? Wherein do you do cystectomy, but at the hilum we should not remove it so that to prevent damage to the normal tissue. Is oocyte preservation done routinely?
Yes, absolutely. We do oocyte preservation very routinely. And remember that it should be done at a good center, because this is something you're going to use after 5 years, 10 years. So that center has to be really good at the freezing technique. And there are some wonderful centers all over our country doing fantastic work. So that would really, I feel that is the key word today in the treatment of endometriosis. Otherwise, what were we doing till now? You know, we were doing egg donation and people are not willing. Trust me, today I see my OPD, nearly 30 to 40% of the patients have a low AMH. Probably because we've become like a tertiary care center. You know, everybody goes locally, fails and then comes to us. So these are the ones which are failure patients with low AMH. And you really have to put in a lot of effort. And also some of them are because of endometriosis. So you must think about oocyte freezing for these patients.
And if the patient is lactating, then what should we?
Lactating, that's good. That's good. Because she's anovulatory.
I know there are a lot of questions, but I don't know how many we should take.
Basav has to decide. Yeah. I think I gave them 1.5 minutes from my talk, plus right. 10 minutes.
Okay,
right.
Two or three.
So I have my 12 minutes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Till we are thrown off the stage, we go ahead.
Okay. Okay. Kalida, Dr. Kalida is Bakshi. He has asked, prolonged use of gynogest, should we be careful about breast cancer?
Doctor, any comment? No, I don't think so. I don't think so.
It is the progestin.
No.
Not the, what I feel, it is progestin. It is not the estrogenic influence.
Yeah.
So why should you be bothered for your...
No, I mean they do say if you add progesterone to the HRT, the breast cancer rate goes up. But I wouldn't know with this drug. I don't know.
Dr. Sanjeev Biswas, role of aromatase inhibitor in endometriosis.
Oh, that's fantastic. That is something that has been recommended, and especially in postmenopausal endometriosis, letrozole has been recommended, especially after hysterectomy, BSO. If there is endometriosis which has come up, it has been recommended, and it works beautifully well.
Again from webcast.
In case of adenomyosis with significant uterine enlargement and poor AMH with recurrent endometrioma post-surgery, can LNG-IUS insertion for short duration prior to planning IVF be a good option? And this is from Nagpur Center.
Yeah, I would use a GnRH analog for 6 months in this patient because you can't really push her away for too long. And I think a surgery also, for debulking surgery, is also recommended nowadays, and it's a very good idea. Yes, LNG can be used, but then you have to give nearly a year for the endometrium to recover from, if you're keeping it for 5 years. So I wouldn't personally use LNG. I would use GnRH analogs in these patients. And adenomyosis success rate is lower, so surrogacy, just now, surrogacy is legal right now. So you can actually use this option for this patient at this point.
What is the role of a resurgery in cases of recurrence endometriomas when AMH is rising?
Don't do it, get her pregnant.
A surgery before IVF or
no.
IUI again?
I would prefer to get her pregnant before I do resurgery, unless the endometrioma is really large.
Actually, this is the question which can be handed over to Dr. Prakash Trivedi, Dr. Prabhudas Dasmapatro, and you can speak for hours together.
Yeah.
So, better to concise. Dr. Purva Sahakari, what is the role of ulipristal in endometriosis? What duration?
I think Prakash is going to handle it, but there's no role.
Dr. Kobita, what if the patient conceives while on dynagest?
I think you should stop the drug immediately. I believe that if this patient conceives, it's a very, very precious pregnancy. And the effect of any of these drugs is 5%, 10%. So I think we have to take a calculated risk, do all the tests and continue with the pregnancy. But then this is a medico-legal, you know, you're entering into that area. It is totally between the patient and yourself. But stop the drug immediately. Difficult to have a patient conceiving on dynagest. Unless the patient's already pregnant and you started the dynagest, you know. So you better confirm if there's amenorrhea, better do a beta HCG before starting.
A focal adenomyoma in 41-year-old infertile patient. Is resection helpful?
Yes, yes. Focal adenomyoma, superb surgery, works wonderfully. Please do it. And do the AMH, do the AMH, do the AMH, do the AMH. That's the one lesson I want you to take home, and oocyte cryopreservation. I think these are the two take home messages today from my talk at least.